Capra, and I am really very pleased to be here tonight to talk to you about Audubon citizen science. I'm a retired scientist, but not conservation or environmental science, so when it comes to the topic that I'm going to talk about tonight, I'm very much a citizen scientist. And I'm very happy to be able to address this, because as I got into the subject, I thought the talk was just going to be about one big event, the Christmas bird count, which is the longest running citizen science project in the world. Actually started in 1900, and I'm going to go through a little bit of history about the Christmas bird count, and after that talk a little bit about what it has been used for, and since this is a science talk, something about some of the challenges in using the data and ways that that was addressed, as well as how the data were used. Then I'm going to go into another project, the North American Breeding Bird Survey. Now I have this asterisk here because the North American Breeding Bird Survey was not a citizen science, an Audubon-sponsored project. It was a project that was sponsored by the USGS and the Canadian Wildlife Service. But the people who do the surveys are all volunteer citizen scientists, and most of them belong to Audubon. And there's actually a couple of them, or at least one sitting here in the room, who does a breeding bird survey, and that's Ron Hauser. I don't know if there are others who do or not, but if you are, thank you for the efforts. The reason I'm going to talk about that a little bit is because the work that the Christmas bird count contributed to was greatly supplemented by the North American Breeding Bird Survey, and that is the climate change study that Audubon has been doing for the last quite some years. They made their big proclamation in 2014, but they've been publishing climate-related work associated with changing patterns of birds, and I'll get into that later. Then I want to talk briefly about climate change pilot study, which is a study that actually tests some of the predictions of the data that came out of the Christmas bird count and the North American Breeding Bird Survey. And then I want to get everyone in the room involved. I want to talk about two projects, and one reason I really wanted to do this talk tonight is that coming up in mid-February is the Great Backyard Bird Count, and everyone can participate in that, and I want to talk a little bit about that and how you can get involved. And if that's a little bit too strenuous for you, there's a really neat project called Hummingbirds at Home, and you can also participate in that when the hummingbirds come back. So these are just some of the Audubon citizen science initiatives. Most of the citizen science initiatives that Audubon hosts is at this level. This is kind of like a food pyramid, only it's a citizen science pyramid. And it has different levels of participation. And actually, many of the projects fit in this contributory or novice level, which involves data collection, like counting birds, quantitative measurements, and transcription of data that can then be used for scientists for publication purposes and conservation strategy planning. Okay, so back around the turn of the 19th century, now that we get into the 21st century, we have to be careful about what we say. There was a great decimation of birds. Birds were being wiped out by a number of societal pressures, and one of them was the fact that they were very fashionable in ladies' hats. And here you see some feathers. And actually, in 1886, Frank Chapman, the ornithologist curator for the National Museum in New York, of Natural History in New York, went about the streets of New York City and just counted the different numbers of birds that he could see on ladies' hats. And he found 174 examples on his one-day bird walk, this special sort of bird walk, representing 40 species, ranging from just feathers to carcasses of whole birds, being worn as a fashion statement by ladies. Well, he started the journal Bird Lore, which ultimately became the Audubon magazine, Frank Chapman, shown here on the left. And in his writings in 1889, he promulgated a different idea. He suggested, I didn't tell you about the side hunts, the other pressure. One of the big things that did happen at Christmas was that hunters would form teams, and they would go out and they would literally hunt to kill as many birds as they possibly could. And the purpose of the hunt was just to see who could get the biggest number of birds and which team would win. So this kind of pressure, the feathered hats and the millinery that ladies wore, as well as the side hunt, were really, really making a significant impact on reducing populations of birds. So Frank Chapman proposed in 1889 that folks get together and do something a little different, that they actually do a bird count on Christmas Day. And he had, he got 27 volunteers who did 25 bird counts ranging from the Northeast to California, and they counted about 89 species of birds kicking off the first Christmas bird count in 1900, and they counted 18,900 individual birds on that first Christmas bird count. And as we go through, we'll see that a lot has changed since then in terms of the numbers and participation. The Christmas bird count now is standardized. It's held at one day between the period of December 14th and January 5th. It's not always on Christmas Day, but groups that participate in it tend to pick pretty close to the same day for their counts. And I want to talk a little bit about the design, about recent results, both the last year's Christmas bird count at the global level, as well as our most recent, the Bay County Audubon and Friends' most recent count, this last Christmas bird count. Talk about some of the data applications, management challenges, and publications. So, this is a little bit about the design, and what we see on this crowded figure over here on the left are a lot of little circles, over 2,500 circles, and in fact, this is from the 117th, the most recent Christmas bird count, so this could be somewhere between 25 and 3,000. I don't really know the exact number. But all the yellow circles are unfilled places where people could register to have a bird count, and the red ones are full. So if we zoom in a little bit and look at a familiar territory here around the panhandle, you see that there were quite a few Christmas bird counts, and they were all, they're designed in what we call circles. The Christmas bird count circle is an area where people follow specified routes and look for and count birds over a 24-hour period. They count as many birds as they see and count as many species as they see and keep the record of this data, and I'll go a little bit more into that in a second. But what we want to do is zoom in a little bit further on our territory. The circles are 15 miles across, 15 miles across, 24 kilometers. And each circle is sampled every year. We did our 53rd bird count. Some of our participants have been birding for as many as 30 years and have really made a tremendous, tremendous contribution to the Christmas bird count. Plus, they bring experience to it. So anyway, the circle is subdivided into sectors, and individual teams will take a sector and will go into a sector and count all of the birds along selected routes for a certain period of time. There's a record kept of the weather conditions, of the amount of time that's used for birding, and any other important variables that pertain. And each team varies in number, but we have maybe sometimes 4 to 6 people in a team. Rarely more than that, but there's usually a very experienced birder or more than one experienced birder in each circle, so that really helps to add certainty to the identifications. And it also allows to bring in new birders who are good at seeing birds but may not know all the species, and they can lean to the more experienced people for information. So in the 116th Christmas bird count, which began in December of 2015 and ran into early January 2016, there were 76,669 observers worldwide, and it included 2,505 circles. They identified 2,607 species, which is about 20 or a little more than 25% of all the existing species of birds that are known. And the count of birds was 58,878,071, which is pretty impressive. Now here, at our bird count, which took place in December of 2016, was our, the 117th CBC, or bird count, and Bay County did pretty well by it. This is, as I said, our 53rd annual Bay County count. We had 57 participants. You saw the sectors. We had 12 teams, one for each sector. 140 species were identified, plus three in count week. We keep a record of the birds that are identified in count week, although they're actually not used in the official data breakdowns for the Christmas bird count. They're very important to have, though. It's kind of like the tail end of distributions. Not quite, but sort of. At any rate, very proud to discover that we had 18,991 individual birds counted, which is more than the first CBC, but we're just 12 people in one circle, so we're pretty proud of that. And this is some of the hardworking team, including yours truly over here, and Brian, and Ron is taking the picture, so he's not in there. And anyway. Mary Jo's kind of hidden back there. Okay, we'll move on. After we finish the bird count work out in the field, we usually meet somewhere for dinner and we tabulate the results. It's a working dinner, even though we do have some refreshments. And at this point, I want to acknowledge two very important people and one of the youngest members of the group. Rhea Pruner and Marvin Frill. Never forgive me for mispronouncing his name, are the people who really are the compilers. They get the data from all the groups and tally it up and do all the hard work afterward. Well, actually, they organize the bird count, get us all together, and do the hard work afterward. And in the meantime, they have a newborn baby here named Caspian. And Caspian is our newest Audubon member and the youngest participant in our 117th bird count. So we owe them a tremendous debt of gratitude, Marvin and Rhea, for their efforts. So what are some of the challenges of the Christmas bird count? You can think about this massive study with thousands of participants. Well, in 2003, the National Audubon Society put together an expert panel of birders, and some of them weren't necessarily their best friends. They were their harshest critics. And they sat down and they looked at all the rules and regulations, and one of the problems they had with the Christmas bird count is that there weren't really enough rules and regulations. They found that the study was weakly standardized. There was, as experienced by variability and group effort and expertise. Well, the expertise I'm not so worried about for reasons I just explained to you. Most sectors inside a circle do have very experienced birders, and the inexperience of some is offset by their enthusiasm and ability to identify birds, which is pretty important. There's not a systematic coverage of different habitats, and there's related to that is non-random distribution of CBC circles. There's actually some errors in historic data, and the data at the time that they did this study needed to be made more available. This was before, there's been a lot of breakthrough in computing power since 2003, and we can do things with making data more available. So a lot of these issues were raised in the findings of their meetings, and they made good suggestions to get the most out of the bird counts, the Christmas bird count, because the Christmas bird count is the most massive study and has the spatial and geographic resolution to make very important observations. And as a result, just the sheer enormity of the project carries a great deal of scientific weight. And if they tried to take this study and make it overly rigorous in sampling, then things would happen like we would lose people that would volunteer. And we would lose connections. We wouldn't be able to use contemporary data against older data because it wouldn't be comparable. So a lot of recommendations were made, and nowadays the Christmas bird count is pretty well accepted by all scientific groups, and it's continuing on with slight improvements and has a great deal of respect in the scientific community. This is a Baltimore Oriole that we saw on this count. Baltimore Orioles aren't the rarest birds in the world, but we haven't seen too many on our bird count, so I put a picture in here, and it was one of the almost, well, an unusual bird for our Christmas bird count. So how are the data used? Because of the enormity of the data collection effort worldwide, it's perfect for identifying general patterns of bird distribution and abundance. And since it's done in the winter, it's a winter count. It's generally a non-breeding count. Birds that are, have migrated south in the winter, for example, here. It's good for looking at changes in bird life over time, including changes in distribution. Studies of broad-scale population eruption. I said, what in the world is an eruption? Is it misspelled? But actually, that's a term. Occasionally, it's not exactly what some of us call a fallout as birders, but it's when a large, unexpected number of various species show up in a season that you really didn't expect. And the example, to some extent, I don't know how large it was, but the snowy owls that came south to extent is sort of an eruption. But there are a lot of different ones, and actually just learning about eruptions, I'm kind of interested in documenting more and getting a better idea of how many actually have occurred. I'm trying to get ahead of myself here. An important thing about these counts is that it allows tests of specific hypotheses about causes and patterns of population change. When the population change is noticed, then using various modeling techniques like I'm going to discuss with the climate studies, a great deal can be learned by these by the data that are obtained from the Christmas bird count. And also, I'll introduce the Breeding Bird Survey soon. And of course, it is now an accepted data source for government agencies and conservation planning. The Christmas bird count was almost the sole contributor to the first State of the Birds report. And now the State of the Birds report, the 2016, is such a massive effort that incorporates multiple groups that there are many data sources, and I might talk a little about that later if we have time. And a very important aspect of this is that it provides for public participation, citizen science participation, and enhances the public appreciation for science and the environment. So that's kind of a fallout benefit. But over 200 publications, and still counting, have been derived on data collected from Christmas bird count. And the ones that I'm kind of showcasing here have to do with climate change, because in 2014, the Audubon came out with its climate report based on its observations of the 40 years of Christmas bird count data. And this is just some of the papers, some very nice recent papers, this Population Trends for North American Winter Birds based on hierarchical models, a very fancy title. Actually, reading through the abstract of this just shows you how much modern computer power has allowed the Audubon scientists to go back, get data, mine the data, and use it for modeling studies today. It's really amazing how much progress they've made. So I want to throw in a bit about the North American Breeding Bird Survey here. Although, as I mentioned, it's not an initiative primarily of Audubon, it's just that Audubon people use it. It's the joint project of the USGS and Canadian Wildlife Service. It started in 1966 and continues on to the present. It has a slightly different protocol. In this case, what happens is people follow a route. The route is a route, and the route is 24.5-mile driving route, and they will stop, they'll make 50 stops, 53-minute stops, and point count all of the birds that are heard or seen at that point. And then they will move on to the next one. So this is the protocol for this, and actually, to use the data with the Christmas bird count, some massaging had to be done. I won't bore you with that because I don't remember all of it. But they were able to make the database or data sets comparable so that they could use the data. Today, there are over 3,700 3,700 routes in the breeding bird count. And together now, the breeding bird count has been used with the Christmas bird count to learn some things about birds. This shows the 2009, some of the results from the 2009 Audubon study. And what they showed with 40 years of data from 1966 to 2005 is that birds are moving north. And the average distance that the species examined moved was about 35 miles, but there's some really 35 miles north. Some also move further inland. But some really startling examples here, a purple finch in a 40-year period moved in its migration north 433 miles. The American robin, which we've seen quite a few of this year, has moved north 206 miles in its winter distribution. So they don't come as far south. And it's interesting that this correlates with a change in average temperature in the U.S. over the same time period. And this led to some thoughts about the relationship between climate change and patterns of bird distribution. In other words, can birds truly predict the scenarios that we have in terms of changing climate? So to do that, the Audubon undertook this massive climate study, which, as I said already, involved two databases, the breeding bird survey, which, and I didn't say, the breeding bird survey is done in the summer. And the Christmas bird count is done in the winter. So you have the breeding survey during the summertime and the CBC in the winter when the animals, most of the birds are not breeding. Okay. And of course, we heard from John's very nice talk a few months ago about global climate change, and we heard about the increase in greenhouse gases, and I don't want to go into global climate change into the depth of the science. What I want to talk about is what we've learned about how birds respond to what looks like changing climate scenarios and changing carbon emission scenarios. And in order to do that, Audubon borrowed data. These are some global emission scenarios for the 21st century. This was done by the a group who did a special report on emission scenarios. It was the International Committee for Tropical Agriculture, and they came up with multiple scenarios from really curtailing gases emissions of carbon to keeping up with business as usual. And Audubon borrowed some of these. They borrowed three scenarios and they combined it with something called a general model, climate model, the GCM, and came up with climate predictions at three different scenarios. They chose what was a B2 scenario and the A1B scenario and A2. And basically the B2 is that there would be a significant reduction. We would do everything responsibly that we could to reduce carbon and other greenhouse gas emissions and half the 1990 emissions, the constant 1990 emissions, the A1B, or the A2, business as usual. And what they did was they took these three scenarios and looked at or made predictions at three time periods. They made a prediction for 2020, a prediction for 2050, and a prediction for 2080 about where birds would be following these changes in carbon emissions, which also correlated with changes in temperature. And to do the temperature modeling, they looked at 17 bioclimatic variables. They looked at an entire range of temperatures, a range of precipitation, and the driest, the wettest and the driest months. So they took 17 layers, as it were, of climactic changes. That is, they would look at each time point from each area. These data came from the Canadian Wildlife Service. of contemporary weather data, and they came up with what they called a correlative distributed model. And the model took each of those climatic variables, each of the 17, and they combined that with the species data and formulated a mathematical model. And the model was then projected back into geographic space so we could understand it. In other words, they made prediction maps of the United States of where birds were under certain climatic, or where they would move to under certain climatic conditions. And it's really, really very impressive if you go to the Audubon site and the climate study, and I'll show you some of these. You can go through the birds that they have and pick some of your favorites and really see some startling things. But basically, they confirmed the 2009 study and hands down with the fact that birds are on the move, including this little prothonotary warbler that you see sometime at Conservation Park. These guys fly through here in around April, and they're very beautiful to see. And this guy, the prothonotary warbler, along with about eight other species of neotropic warblers, which winter down south in Latin America and then fly up through here to reach their breeding grounds in the summer. Nine of them have moved up dramatically in their distribution to they go much further north now than they used to. And that has consequences in terms of whether or not they will find the proper habitat, and the proper food sources when they get there. So looking at all of these data, all these climatic changes, and all of the bird distribution changes for the last 40 years, they were able to find that birds' ranges varied in three basic ways. They would either expand their range so that their original range of distribution could be enlarged, which could be a good thing as long as the bird in question or birds in question can find what they need to survive and thrive. So they can expand. They can shift from one area or to another, but basically maintain the same size of a range. Or a little bit more precarious, they can contract and lose space, where they have actually less habitable space to breed, do other things, to survive. And this is probably one of the worst cases. So based on this type of modeling and the results of the study, Audubon concluded, at least for this point, that there were 314 species, over 500 were looked at. 314 species were impacted by climate change. This is a picture of the website. This is where you can pick any of your own favorite birds. I'm just going to show you some of a couple of birds because this could go on forever, and I know you don't want that to happen. But let me tell you a little bit about what this means. 314 species were impacted by climate change. And out of those species, out of the 314 species, there were two groups, the climate threatened group, which may lose over 50% of their current range by 2080, and a climate endangered group, which may lose over 50% of its current range as early as 2050. And out of these, they had 184 species, 188 species were climate threatened, and 126 were judged to be climate endangered. So let me just show you a couple of examples of these. This is the little Dunlin, and we have Dunlins around here. You can see their winter distribution here in blue, and they hang around here in the mud flats and eat things and get healthy enough to fly all the way north to where their breeding grounds are. And once they get there, they do their thing, but there's a problem. In their summer breeding grounds, the prediction is that there will be a 94% decrease in summer 2080 from the current 2000 range, which is currently stable. And I'm sorry, this Venn diagram is a little bit light, but here you see the representation of its current winter range. I'm sorry. That's backwards. This is the winter range. The 0% of the winter range is stable. There's a 94% decrease in the winter range. I apologize for that on the slide. And here the summer range is stable, 37% is stable, but 38% increase in the summer can occur according to the predictions of the climate study. So they have some saving grace here, but not as, I really blew it. The summer range is where they breed, and they're going to lose their summer range. The winter range is where they are now, and it's fairly stable, but it shifts, and I apologize for that. But this is a climate-endangered species, and the Dunlin is one. The snowy plover is also in danger, but the data was not as striking, and I went out of my way to confuse you anyway. So, but the thing about the shorebirds is that it's not just about climate. Well, except for the fact that sea level rise is also associated with climate. And that's where you get into trouble, because not only do we have to worry about just the temperature changes, but we have to worry about what's going to happen to our shorebirds with various scenarios of climate change, of sea level rise. And this is probably a little bit far-fetched, but it kind of makes the point. This is a prediction of a 20-foot rise, and I think it was about a century away. At any rate, you can get much more realistic models from Climate Central. You can model your own beachfront property if you have it, and it can be pretty scary. I didn't want to go that direction tonight. I just wanted to impress you that the shorebirds have an additional serious problem, and they have to be managed not only for eventuality of climate temperature change, but also sea level rise associated with it. Now, I want to talk about another species, a local species, and one of our favorites. We have these out on our feeder because we have a lot of pine trees in the yard. This bird is not a migratory bird. This is the little brown-headed nuthatch, and he likes to hang around pine trees, and he walks up and down, upside down on pine trees, and has a nice little sound we call a squeaky toy sound. You can see a lot of these at St. Andrews in the longleaf pines there, and they're kind of neat little birds to watch. But here's the story. The story is that they don't migrate a lot. And if we look at the 2020 scenarios, you can see their range here, 0% of the summer range is stable, and there's a 95% decrease in the range by 2080, and that's shown here. The gray is the current range, or the current weather prediction range, and you see it's reducing, and with the worst case scenario. With the winter range, what you have is something a little different. The bird doesn't lose really that much of its total range, but it shifts. It almost becomes a migratory bird with increasing climate change or increasing temperatures. And the problem is any gains that it may have by expanding its range here are offset by the fact that they can't thrive when they're breeding. So that's a problem. Now, to take that a step further, Audubon has recently started another citizen science project. It's primarily limited to Audubon chapters, and I'm only going to show you one slide from it because I just wanted to go through it and then get to some things that you can do. Basically, now we're monitoring two what they call charismatic birds. And the reason that they're monitoring these birds, partly related to the story that I told you about the brown-headed nuthatch, they want to test the hypothesis that some of these predictions are actually working, and they're throwing a habitat layer into this. So again, there will be a sampling protocol that involves a square of data, and volunteer citizen scientists will go in and measure or count birds in these areas, and the habitat will be chosen as ideal bluebird, eastern bluebird habitat, or brown-headed nuthatch. And I say that for around here because these are the most of what you're going to see here, but out in the west you have other species of bluebirds. They're going to be looking at those bluebird species out west. We also have four species of nuthatch, and they will be looked at. But here in Bay County, if we were to do this study, and we may start this summer, It would be primarily looking at the brown-headed nuthatch, although this winter we've had something that we haven't seen since 2013. We've had some red-breasted nuthatches come down. And these red-breasted nuthatches don't normally make it this far south, but we've had quite a few counts of those this year. We even had some of our in our yard. Anyway, there's something known as the important bird areas in the United States. And the important bird areas in the United States are actually generated by the North American, I'm sorry, I want to credit the right people here. And I don't think I have it. Bird Life, I believe, is the group that started the, maybe I can see it right here, National International Birding. Ron, do you know who the Bird Life, that's it. The Bird Life Association started the important bird areas, and these areas were established because they are known to be high priority areas for birds and survival for birds. And these are monitored regularly by citizen scientists and kept up. And the numbers of important bird areas are increasing as we go by. Actually, even though it's not initially the important bird areas in the United States weren't chosen initially by Audubon. Audubon now manages the important bird areas, and they have used some of their climate study data to help guide the locations, the choice of locations for new important bird areas. And I'm not even going to begin to go into this data, but what they did with some of the climate data is they looked at species richness throughout the country using some of that same type of modeling I described to you, the correlative modeling. And they came up with climate strongholds, areas that basically will tend to provide continued good habitat and support for birds, regardless of changes in climate. In this picture, what you see on the left is a lot of green, and green is good, number one. And red is bad, zero. In other words, what happens over time with changing climate, if you look at, this has happened before. Here we go. If you look at changing climate with the different scenarios, basically you see a gradual shift with more red in the worst case scenario up here in 2080 at the business as usual scenario. But down here in what is called no regrets, you see a continued area of green, right, well, kind of yellowish green. It's kind of faded some. But note where it is. It's in the center of the country. And if you go back to the bird map, important bird areas map, look where there's a dearth of important bird areas. So actually now Audubon is beginning to advise the organizations to create more important bird areas here in the center of the country, because it looks like these areas for the birds that can survive there, obviously some birds aren't going to find that suitable habitat, but for the birds that can survive there, the habitat can be made as usable and protected as possible. So that's one of the way that the climate studies help guide conservation managers and planners and that sort of thing. So one of the things that just continues to really impress me are the wonderful tools that Audubon and the Cornell Laboratory of Ornithology have made available for citizen sciences. And I wanted to introduce those to you today and even get you hopefully involved in some of them. Now, I'm going to have some internet links and everything as we go forward, but if you remember ebird.org and you remember audubon.org and certainly ebird will get you to some of the most impressive tools that you could ever hope to imagine as a beginning birder or as a citizen scientist or hopefully both. eBird is becoming now the recognized portal for reporting bird data. And my wife gets up every morning and does a bird count every morning and logs it into eBird. And there's some other folks here who do that too. But all of this data goes into an international database that the Cornell Laboratory of Ornithology monitors. And it is now the official recognized reporting area agency for most people who engage in citizen science studies. Other important tools, Audubon Works is for folks who are members of Audubon, and there is a treasure trove of resources there. There are library articles about the science, all of the science studies, the climate studies that I've mentioned are there in one way or another. They have a library section. They have initiatives such as those I'm about to talk about, the Great Backyard Bird Count. There are posters there. There's ways to start petitions for your important causes. But it's a very valuable tool for citizen scientists. To support your learning of birds that you can report, the Audubon Society has Audubon Birds. This is a field guide that is available for iPhone and the Android phones, absolutely free and downloadable. And this will give you the not only pictures of the birds and the breeding and non-breeding plumage, but also their range, their distribution, something about their nesting. And it really will help you get a head start on birding and you can carry it around in your pocket. The tool from Cornell called Merlin. It's particularly designed for the beginning birder because it walks you through an algorithm, a series of steps. It asks you, for example, how large is the bird that you saw, and it shows some silhouettes, and you just fill in a circle, and it'll take you to the next step, and it'll ask you what color did you see in the bird, and so on through several steps, and it will gradually narrow down, and one of the neatest, and make some suggestions about what your bird might be. One of the neatest things they've just added is a photo identification feature so that you can go in and if you can take a picture of a bird with your phone or with the camera and then get it to your phone, you can then send it to Merlin. I say that loosely, but Merlin can look at it, and that's without using the technical computer sense of how it actually gets to see that image. But it will look at it and recommend the birds. And sometimes it works very well. You can actually identify a bird you don't know by asking Merlin to find it for you. Sometimes it doesn't work very well at all because it's early in development. But with the help of citizen scientists, birders, they will send in new pictures, they will tell people when pictures don't work, and ultimately we should be able to have something pretty close to a take a picture, show it to Merlin, and have Merlin tell you what the bird is if you don't know what it is. And I think probably for native plants folks, you're going to see the same thing with native plants in terms of identification and that sort of thing. I think it's very exciting. But this is where Audubon and Cornell is now. I'm on another neat little tool I'll get to in just a minute is Hummingbirds at Home. There's an app for the Hummingbirds at Home. But I haven't told you about what I really want to sell today, the Great Backyard Bird Count. So February 17th through the 20th. And that's why I wanted to give this talk this day rather than postponing. Everybody in this room can participate in the Great Backyard Bird Count. And the place to go to get started is birdcount.org. And if you go to birdcount.org, you'll be taken to a portal that will help you get started. This program is sponsored by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology, Audubon, and the Bird Studies of Canada. And it's a lot of fun. It's a global effort, and everyone can participate. If you are already an eBird user and you're good to go, you can just log in because everything that gets logged in and submitted to eBird on the days of the backyard bird count that looks like a backyard bird count, or actually every count, will be considered for the backyard bird count. But if you haven't done it before, you can create the Great Backyard Bird Count by going to birdcount.org. And what you do, it's very simple. you count birds, even though it's called the backyard bird count, you can count birds anywhere. I teach a birding course to the Encore, and I have a fellow who lives in a condo. And he said, well, where can I bird? I said, well, you have a feeder on your porch there? And he said he didn't, but he talked about the shorebirds. And I said, well, the best thing you can do is just walk down and look at the shorebirds, because you don't have to stay in your own actual backyard. Right now, we have a lot of snowbirds down here, and they're not going to be going to their backyard just to do this count. They'll be using their temporary backyard if they choose to participate. And here's an example of that. So you can go to parks. St. Andrews Park is a great place. Camp Helen, nature centers, anywhere you want. And all you do is count birds for at least 15 minutes. Easy enough. You can count them for a lot longer if you want to. If you're really into it, you can count birds for an hour. You can just do one list, or you can do a list every day for the 3 days. It's up to you entirely. But if you can identify one species in your backyard and have 15 minutes to spare and want to have a little fun, then go ahead and get your account set up and log in that bird. Keep track of the time and best estimate of the numbers of species. Now, I need to describe this just a little bit. I still have some time. The way that it works, for example, if you're in your backyard and you have a feeder and you see four chipping sparrows on your feeder at one time, and then you look somewhere else and you've got a little note of that on your piece of paper, or on your mobile device if you're that sophisticated already, and you keep looking, and let's say you see three more. Well, you've seen a total of seven, but you don't write down seven birds. You count down the most of a species that you see at any one time in that 15-minute period. That's just the rules. So that makes it a little bit easier, too. So basically, you count birds and you get your best estimate number of individuals of each species that you identify at one sighting. Okay, so now it's time to submit your data. If you didn't download the app, and actually, if it depends on where you are with computers. It's hard to replace a notebook and scribble down a bird that you identify and the numbers, and you can keep going and keep looking rather than getting tangled up in iPhone app things. It takes a little practice. So if you have it on notes, you can go back to your desktop and you can go to Submit Observations, as is shown here. And when you click on Submit Observations at birdcount.org, you'll be asked to sign in and put in your username and password. If you forgot to get that account, like I've already cautioned you to do, you can set it up right down here under the Create an Account. Okay, Create an Account. Or once you've signed in, you can sign in. You can stay signed in. You can stay signed in for the entire period. After that, it will ask you where you birded, and you can identify it. If you already have locations, you can just select from the locations you've set up before. If you haven't set up locations, you can just type in country, you can type in the county, and there's even a map option in the next step. I don't know if I left that slide in because, yeah, it is. You can even find where you birded on a map, and you can drop a pin, basically, and that will send your coordinates, your GPS, or you can actually type in your GPS coordinates, either way you want to do it, to identify where you did your birding, and that will be sent off to the database. And then you talk a little bit about your effort, whether the date that you actually saw the birds that you're reporting, whether you're traveling on a certain distance, if you did a hike, for example, or whether you just sat in your backyard in a nice comfortable chair and looked around for 15 minutes, you were stationary. Historical is when you don't remember when you saw a bird, so that's not going to happen with the bird count. If you participated in this for the first time, it's going to be either traveling or stationary. If you happen to find a bird later in the day and you think it's a really cool bird and you've never seen one before and somebody tells you it's a rare bird, you can do an incidental account. But we've learned that the incidental counts don't really get counted into the data. It's the traveling and stationary bird counts that you make that are really used by the bird count folks. You're asked about the start time and the duration and the party size down here in this bottom arrow, and you just type in simple things. And then for the backyard bird count, the bird list is alphabetical, which makes life a lot easier for new birders. With the eBird, things are listed in the taxonomic organization classification, and that's a little bit harder. But for the the backyard bird count portal, you actually get a list that if you want to look at a chickadee, you just go to C, and you put in the number of counts that you have on a chickadee. And as you get each species filled, you're asked to add a species, and you will go in, for example, you will not see 10 black-capped chickadees here in Panama City because we don't have the black-capped chickadees. But we do have chickadees, so you will see those, and you can add your species. You may be asked to add details like where you saw it, or whether it was in a tree, or whether it was in the feeding at a feeder, or something like that. And you'll have a little box that you can fill out. And if you get lost, there's a help button up there at the top. There, the help button. And go on to the next species and so on. And ultimately, you get finished, and you said, are you submitting a complete checklist for the birds you're able to identify? And for most folks, the answer to that, and you can share it with them through email. Who compiled the list? The person who compiled the list can send it out to everybody. And then you can start all over again and do it another time, because you'll be so excited at the fun that you had that you'll want to do it again. So here's a little bit of the results. And 2016 Great Backyard Bird Count was 163,000 plus birders from more than 130 countries, 162,000 bird checklists, over half the species in the world, 5,689 were reported, and it was a banner year, more 599 more than the preceding year. And just some results, the highest state ranked state in terms of numbers of species and checklists was California. Florida didn't do too badly, number four out of the 10, and 7,300 plus checklists were submitted. The top 10 birds, top 10 species identified, the dark-eyed junco. We have a few down here, but we don't see that many, so these checklists probably didn't come, a lot of them didn't come from Florida, unless they're very north Florida. But we do have cardinals, mourning doves, downy woodpeckers, blue jays, American goldfinches are like crazy here right now, and we'll be here through the month of February probably. House finches, the tufted titmouse, not the black-capped chickadee, but just a Carolina chickadee will be the one you will see. Looks a lot like the black-capped. And the American crow. That's the one that just goes caw, a single caw, not the double caw. That would be your fish crow. So if that's too challenging for you, I'm going to finish up with this last fun little study, citizen science project called Hummingbirds at Home. And I just discovered this, and the way you do this is by setting up what they're referring to as patch surveys. So if you've got some wildflowers or native plants in your backyard and you want to know whether the hummingbirds are coming there and you want to tell the world about it, then you can designate that area as a patch. And you can have up to six different patches. Or you can do a nectar source survey if you're specifically interested in the nectar of certain plants, or if you want to set up a feeder. You can have a feeder nectar source and have a feeder source. And the thing about this here is the great majority of hummingbirds are just going to be this little guy right here. You only have one species. Anybody want to tell me what that species? Well, you might see another one because birds fly, but the most common species, ruby-throat hummingbird. So you don't have to pour through a lot. But if you do see something that looks different, when you have your downloaded app and you start entering your birds, you will see that it will take you to pictures of hummingbirds. And if you happen to have a picture of a hummingbird not usually seen here, and you take a picture with your camera, then that'll be very exciting. But most of your counts are going to be the ruby throat. And this is the reason for this study is to look at what's becoming a problem with the time that plants now produce nectar in the time the birds arrive, and because of change in climate and other variables, there's a disconnect, and Audubon wants to document the arrival time of hummingbirds and what their preferred nectar sources are, and whether or not later blooming or earlier blooming is a problem. I think we had coreopsis blooming at and other plants blooming at Camp Helen that were chondrodina was blooming. Okay. Anyway, this is just some of the data. I picked out 1 month in the summer just to show you what it looks like reported. Just like all of the other programs, I didn't really mention ArcGIS. That's a powerful tool. All of the mapping things that you can look at now and review your data in is a tool, is an Audubon citizen science tool as well. Takes a little bit of practice, but actually the citizen science has access with permission to access ArcGIS as a working program, but most often you'll just use it as an interface where you will see things like your data and data of other people projected on a map of the United States or wherever you happen to be looking. So here we have, for example, 125 observations from patches. They are not too far from home. So this is a list of the internet resources that you can tap into. As I said earlier, eBird is a critical one, eBird.org, birdcount.org to do the Great Backyard Bird Count. Once you have that account, you will also be able to use that password for eBird. The Cornell site, if you type in birds in Cornell on Google, you will get some of the most beautiful tools, including things like migratory shifts of birds that have been mapped. You can go there now and you can actually look at the migration of a specific species over a one-year period of time and see how it moves. It's pretty impressive. So this is the scissor-tailed flycatcher. This was another bird that we don't usually see around here, but it popped up on our Christmas bird count. We have seen it before. Everybody gets excited when it shows up, and we call folks and try to get a chance to look at it. I actually had opportunity to try and photograph one of these at St. Andrews Park, and wouldn't you know it, he was just outside the reach of my camera. I took the picture as high with the greatest magnification that I possibly could, zoomed in the best I could, and got home and then photoshopped it up, and it was just too blurry to use. So I stole this from somebody. Actually, this was from a tattoo artist. These are some of the tattoos that they proposed to put on people. I don't know which book they took it from, because these are very accurate drawings. So anyway, are there any questions?
Can you tell us how to track cardinals?
I'm sorry? How do you track cardinals? Boy, that's not a big problem with us. But they are seed feeders, and if you have a pretty, they're nice finch bill birds, and you should be able to get them with just a standard bird feed. The sunflower seeds, they come to that. They also, actually, I wish Cindy, you guys, I don't know if you. Know about Wild Birds Unlimited, I'll put in a plug. Cindy and Jim Wolf have some of the best supplies if you want to attract any species, and they will tell you the best way to get them as well. So they're up on 77, is it?
No, you're great. I'm just turning them
on. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, Ron.
Well, for your question, how to affect cardinals, any other bird, you also need cover, shelter, water, you know, same thing. Summertime, they also, or in the spring, they also need protein, so they need bugs, caterpillars, and so that's why you should not be spraying anything in your yard like an insecticide, because you'll kill those things.
Okay, thanks, Ron. Appreciate that. Other questions?
You did such a good job.
Woo!
Thank you.
You know, this what Ron was bringing up and Norm was talking about with the birds, you know, we do need the native plants in our yards, and I think, you know, just to add on to what Ron was talking about, you can't just have a yard that is only lawn grass and then expect to have birds. Even if you put like a nice little bird feeder out, you need to have
shrubs and trees and native plants. And one thing we saw in this Panhandle Wildflower Alliance presentation about a couple weeks ago was that, and this is a great book, Bringing Nature Home by Doug Tallamy, if you're interested. It just talks about how we have to have native plants along our roadsides in our yards if we're going to have these caterpillars that we really need. They are a major source of protein. Think about little tiny hot dogs, right, for birds. They need that, and you got to have those caterpillars, which means you need the plants that the caterpillars live on. So we just can't do it. If you just have long grasses, we're just creating a desert landscape.
But there are specific things you can do to attract certain birds, and as Ron mentioned, you have to have certain basic requirements. But for bluebirds, for example, a bluebird box helps, but it also needs some more open spaces, and there are specific habitat requirements for species, and that's one thing that, and that's why I mentioned Jim and Cindy, is that they really know that stuff and can get you well set up to attract a species of interest to you. And, I know one thing that I haven't done, my wife has done, is with the hummingbirds, using native plants to get the hummingbirds instead of the sugar feeder. It's really exciting to see those guys come up and picking on plants that you put in the yard yourself, as opposed to, you may not see quite as many that way, but on the other hand, maybe you will. Do the hummingbird count and tell me. Yes.
How long do the hummingbirds fly through here?
They come in the spring and they leave. Actually, there were some around here in October. They normally leave before that, I think, Ron, but they lingered this year. There are some residents. So that's, and I we've discussed other species. I don't know, Ron, if you want to comment on that, finding other species of hummingbirds in our area.
Well, it's not, I mean, it's fairly unusual to see other species besides ruby-throated hummingbirds, but you do see some species that come over from Texas, Mexico, work over this area in the winter and fall. Buff-breasted hummingbirds, rufous hummingbirds. So if you see a hummingbird that looks a little bit different, take a picture of it, send it to somebody that you know that's a birder. Maybe next week you'll have a whole bunch of birders coming to your yard.
When are your meetings?
So our meetings are the second Monday of the month at 7:00 at the Science and Discovery Center, and you're certainly welcome to attend. We have a very interesting talk. I think probably some of you know John Bente. We'll be speaking about some of his projects at our next meeting on. Is that the 12th or the 9th? What day is it? The next Monday. The second Monday.
So that's what's fascinating about, there's a lot of students here, so I just want to remind you guys that Bay County, we actually do have a lot of environmental groups, people you can go talk to, especially if you want to become a birder, you don't know how to get started. I think Conservation Park has a birding walk coming up. Is that in February?
February 22nd.
February 22nd. So there's lots of activities you can do if you're interested in getting involved, but you don't know how to bird or you don't even know what equipment you need and stuff. I mean, you can talk to lots of folks here from Audubon. Raise your hand if you're from Audubon. There's a whole bunch of you here. So students, if you're interested in talking with them. Also, if you would like to sign up, if you haven't signed in, please do so. We keep track of it for grant purposes when we are writing grants and we talk about the projects that we're doing and stuff like that. So I'm going to just leave this over here.
Also, if you're interested in joining, Bay County does have a website, Bay County Audubon, and you can go to it and for $20. You get the National Magazine and some other perks.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I was wondering if you had noticed changes locally that correspond with the 2020 predictions for what might happen in terms of climate change?
Well, actually, that climate change pilot is probably going to address that as we begin looking at, and I would really hope to do that. That program is patterned after some of that I told you about. It's a point count program. It doesn't take a lot of time. And I'm hoping to find 10 good volunteers and maybe get that started up so that we can participate in it and look at those two species. And because we do have bluebirds here and we do have nuthatches, and it'd be nice to begin that study, and then somewhere down the road we'll be able to answer some of those questions.
Thank you so much.